Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Talent Tectonics, Navigating Global Workforce Shifts, Building Resilient Organizations, and Reimagining the Employee Experience by Stephen T. Hunt. Narrated by Will Tulin. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to figures and tables present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Foreword. Decades ago, in my first organizational behavior course, my then teacher and now mentor advocated, "Organizations don't think, people do." This mantra became an obsessive quest for me to figure out how people come together to create organizations that so dramatically influence all parts of our lives, how we work, play, eat, dress, and worship. Years later, after lots of observations, research, and writing, I tweaked his mantra. Organizations don't think, people do, but organizations shape how people think, act, and feel. Why does this maxim matter? Because as Steve articulately points out in this impactful book, recent societal trends of digitalization and demographics are changing the ways employees respond to organizations, and how organizations influence employees. With unprecedented physical, social, economic, political, and emotional uncertainties, it behooves business and HR leaders to respond to these changes in positive ways. Steve's ideas help turn potential threats of uncertainty into opportunities for progress. He masterfully offers insights based on solid evidence and relevant experience, coupled with diagnostic questions and useful tools. What I most like is that his blueprint for reimagining work navigates paradoxes that organizations must balance as they seek to support the goals of diverse stakeholders. He does not fall prey to the simplistic trap of moving from A to B, but he recognizes the evolution of ideas that suggests A and also B. Managing the paradox of both A and B requires more complex analysis that leads to more informed decisions. Some of these paradoxes include these actions. Balancing past, present, and future. We do not leave the past behind, but live with it today as we create a better tomorrow. Steve consistently puts new ideas into their historical context and shows the evolution of thinking that cumulatively creates a new future. This applies to psychological trends about why people work, gender equity, workers' rights, employee primacy, and digital evolution. Rather than denigrating the past, he consistently brings it forward into our present, then anticipates what is next. Balancing the individual and the organization. A major insight I take from this book is the clever melding of how individuals, called workforces, employees, talent, people, competence, come together into organizations, called workplaces, teams, cultures, systems, capabilities, to enhance both. Because of people, organizations operate more effectively. Because of organizations, people have higher well-being. The 7 workforce challenges Steve addresses in the book have implications for both how organizations operate, such as how to get the right people into the right roles, and how individuals function within organizations, such as how do I move into a role that works best for me. He talks about agility, both as an organizational capability and as an individual competence. His recognition of both human and organization elements of the future of work adeptly characterizes the inevitable trade-offs that leaders must manage to build effective companies. Balancing information as data and as guidance. With technology advances, all manner of information is ubiquitous at the touch of our fingers through internet search engines, webinars, consulting reports, and social media. It is obviously better to make decisions based on data than merely intuition. But information can also come in the form of more qualitative guidance based on experience. Guidance moves beyond data benchmarking. How do I compare to others? Best practices, who is a good example, and predictive analytics. Why are they effective? To personal insight, how can I be more effective? Steve's recommendations balance use of both structured information, data, and unstructured information, observation, to offer guidance that makes the knowledge he shares not simply informative, but productive. Balancing inside out and outside in. Steve consistently connects what happens inside an organization, e.g., employee attitudes, to what happens outside the organization, e.g., customer attitudes. As I have studied, this virtual cycle of external context connecting to internal actions creates a virtual spiral to make progress in both organizations and society. The future of work is not just taking care of people, but taking care of people so that customers feel taken care of, and customers feel taken care of because of the people who care for them. Customers, employees, and shareholders are more important than the others. Companies must attend to and improve the experience of all groups to be successful. You will discover your own insights from this wonderful book. Reflecting on the paradoxes and topics it addresses, my evolving mantra might be, organizations don't think, people do, but organizations shape how people think, act, and feel, and by doing so, improve personal, organizational, and societal outcomes that matter to all of us. Thanks for a wonderful book that makes a difference both for the future of work and for the future of society. Dave Ulrich, Rensselaer Professor, Ross School of Business, University of Michigan. Partner, the RBL Group. Introduction. How we managed people in the past will not work in the future. Why are we still using management methods created during the Roman Empire? A lot of roads and buildings in Europe can be traced to the Roman Empire. In some cases, people literally walk on stones placed more than 2,000 years ago. Many other inventions created by the Romans also continued to shape our lives. Some endured because they still work, such as crop rotation in farming. Others are still used because they are familiar, even if they are not very effective. Hierarchical organization structures and the associated org charts used by companies belong in this category. Org charts categorize workforces based on how they are connected via higher-level leadership positions. If the person in the role of governor of imperial provinces, on the left of figure 1.1, had an issue with the administrator of Rome and Italy, on the right, they would first go to their leader, the amici Caesaris, who would talk to the proco imp Maius, who would then communicate to the Consilium Semestre, who would finally tell the admin of Rome and Italy. This top-down method for workforce management has been familiar to leaders since the Roman Empire, but it has significant limitations when applied to the modern workforce. Hierarchical organizational structures were created to manage workforces during a time when work was largely defined by geography. Prior to the 21st century, where people physically lived heavily influenced the work they did and whom they worked with. Team members all worked in the same building with their immediate leaders. Org charts usually mirrored how the workforce was structured geographically. The rise of the internet economy has created a split among people's location, roles, and work relationships. Teams are no longer constrained by geography. It is common for people to work in one city, report to a manager in another city, and collaborate with people across the world. Org charts might accurately reflect how a company reports financial numbers, but they contain little information about the roles, social interactions, and relationships that drive those numbers. Where an employee is placed on an org chart may tell little about what they do or who they work with. The continued use of org charts also reflects a top-down leadership style that is antithetical to the cross-functional nature of most modern organizations. It implies that decision-making authority resides in roles higher up the chart, which disempowers frontline employees to act quickly. Because org charts may provide little insight into what people actually do or how they work together, using org charts to guide workforce decisions can also result in inadvertently firing the wrong people and disrupting team relationships that are critical to a company's performance. I have known multiple companies that let employees go based on their positions on an org chart, only to discover that these people were doing work that was critical to the company's performance. In several cases, they had to rehire the people as contractors at much higher pay rates with much lower levels of organizational commitment. Innovations in technology have created tools that are far superior to org charts for capturing information about the employee roles, skills, and relationships that make a company function. Relatively few companies have adopted these tools, largely because it would require leaders to change how they make decisions. At some point, leaders will stop clinging to their love of org charts. When that day comes, employees will rejoice in seeing org charts jettisoned to join bronze swords, lead plumbing, and other things from the Romans that were once useful, but are now at best inefficient and at worst harmful. The purpose of this book is to help organizations build workforces for a future that is very different from the past. It discusses how the twin talent tectonic forces of digitalization and demographics are changing the nature and purpose of work. It explains the psychology of employee experience and why it is critical to building adaptable organizations that can thrive in a world of accelerating change and frequent skill shortages. It discusses how to integrate business strategy, psychology, and technology to create more nimble companies. And it explains why we must move beyond ineffective workforce management methods based on outdated technology, such as hierarchical org charts. This book discusses the future, but its focus is on the present, identifying things companies can do now to attract talent and create resilient organizations. It also talks about the one thing about work that is not changing, the psychology of the people who work in organizations, and how employee experience influences their engagement, performance, and adaptability. This book looks at these topics from the perspective of an industrial organizational psychologist who has helped thousands of companies around the world use technology to build effective workforces. Few people have viewed the future of work from this particular angle. The book is based on engagements with organizations spanning virtually every industry. Most stories and examples in this book are based on companies I have worked with over my career. I do not share names of companies for several reasons. First, not all the stories are positive. Second, I do not want people to evaluate an example based on the name of the company that did it. Just because a company has a strong public brand does not mean it has good workforce management methods. The company Enron was widely admired for years, despite using abhorrent workforce management methods to create fraudulent financial results. Conversely, many great workforce management methods are found in privately held organizations few people have heard of. Company names are not what matters. What matters is what we can learn from company practices. It also incorporates a range of research from industrial organizational psychology, management science, socioeconomics, and related fields. The book is a product of extensive experience working at the intersection of people, technology, and work. My goal as an author is to draw on this experience to share business insights you may not have considered and practical psychological knowledge you may not have encountered. The book includes fairly extensive citations. If you wish to dive more deeply into the science and data underlying many of these concepts and observations, the book provides guidance on how to attract, retain, develop, engage, and manage people for a new world of work, keeping in mind there is no one best way to manage workforces. My career involves working with companies over multiple years, and I have seen how workforce management techniques play out over time. Theoretically well-designed processes often fail in application. Methods that work in one company fail in others, and methods that worked in one company at one time may not work later based on changing technologies, leadership characteristics, and company resources. It is critical to determine what solutions are appropriate for an organization given its unique culture, business needs, and resource constraints. Each chapter in the book ends with a set of questions to discuss with company leaders, managers, and/or employees to determine what makes sense for the organizations you work with. A goal of this book is to help you understand why these questions matter, when they are important to discuss, and what to consider when answering them. Content overview. This book is meant to be heard from beginning to end. However, the chapters stand on their own for listeners who are interested in specific topics. The first three chapters address changes reshaping work and workforce management. The remaining chapters provide guidance on how to respond to these changes. The content of the chapters is summarized next. Forces Reshaping Work and Workforces, Chapter 1. The phrase talent tectonics describes fundamental shifts reshaping work and organizations. The two biggest shifts are the accelerating pace of change caused by digitalization and the reshaping of labor markets caused by demographic changes in birth rates and lifespans. Digitalization. As technological innovation expands into every facet of life, it increases the speed of change. This affects multiple aspects of corporate life, including company survival. The lifespan of companies is growing shorter, while the acquisition rate of companies has steadily increased. Companies are restructuring faster than ever before. Industries are being altered with changes in one industry, creating changes in another. For example, the shift to electric cars is transforming the automotive industry, but also has massive implications for the energy, transportation, mining, oil and gas, and manufacturing industries. This level of change is also playing out at the level of individual jobs. Automation is eliminating long-standing tasks while creating new types of work. Even enduring professions such as land surveying, which dates back to the ancient Egyptians, are being completely altered by inventions such as satellite and drone technology. Whatever a company or job looks like now, it will almost certainly look different in 3 years. Demographics. People are living longer and having fewer children, and not just by a small amount. The life expectancy in the U.S. has increased by 38 years since 1910. The generation of workers currently entering the economy can expect to live about one-third longer than their great-grandparents. At the same time, the global birth rate has declined by 51% since 1950. In many countries, more people are leaving the labor market than entering it. Barring catastrophic events such as wars, this has never happened in modern history. It is creating growing labor shortages and redefining job markets. Companies are already struggling to find skilled employees, and filling job roles is predicted to become even more challenging. Similar to how movement of geological tectonic plates drives changes on the surface of the Earth, these two talent tectonic shifts are creating visible changes in the nature of organizations and work. Companies can treat these shifts as threats to be managed or opportunities to be leveraged, but either way, they must adapt to survive. This starts with understanding how these technological and socioeconomic forces are changing the nature of work, jobs, organizations, and careers. Employee Experience and Workforce Adaptability, Chapter 2. The world of work is radically changing, with one critical exception. Organizations will always employ people, and the fundamental psychology of people is relatively constant. Despite popular assertions that generations are radically different from one another, studies dating back to the 1920s show that the nature of what people want from work does not change much over time. The things that make us happy, engaged, and healthy at work are rooted in human psychological attributes that do not evolve as quickly as technology and societies. What does change is the ability of people to demand better employee experiences at work. To illustrate this concept, consider two historic talent tectonic shifts from the 20th century: the workers' rights movement and the women's suffrage movement. Coal miners in the late 19th century did not know what black lung disease was, but they did know that working in the mines was killing them prematurely. Coal companies did not pay much attention to how miners felt about their safety, given the social values and labor markets at the time. Miners were unable to demand change lest they lose their jobs and the ability to provide for their families. Miners did not get protection for black lung disease until the workers' rights movements of the early 20th century changed social values regarding the obligation of companies to protect the health and safety of employees. The workers' rights movement did not change miners' desire for a better work environment. What changed was their ability to demand healthier working conditions. In the early 20th century, social attitudes toward educating women radically shifted due to the women's suffrage movement. This led to an increase in women achieving college degrees throughout the 20th century. The rise in women's education led to large numbers of women in the 1960s and 1970s launching careers in professions that had historically been limited to men. These women faced openly sexist behavior and blatant sexual discrimination in pay and promotions. Working women in the 1970s did not like this discrimination, but many did not feel empowered to overtly challenge it. By the beginning of the 21st century, more women were graduating from college than men in many countries. As more women entered the workforce, social attitudes continued to shift toward gender equity, and overt sexism and blatant discrimination were no longer tolerated. We have a lot of work to do to achieve full gender equity, but this is not a function of changing what working women want. Working women always wanted to be treated fairly and respectfully. What has and continues to change is their ability to demand they be treated as equals. This example reflects stories my mother shared as a professional woman who founded a company in 1972. Working women of her generation demonstrated amazing strength and determination, overcoming sexist attitudes about the capabilities of women. These examples illustrate how past talent tectonic forces have driven companies to create better working conditions and employee experiences. Chapter 2 explains why improving how employees experience work is critical to responding to the current talent tectonic forces of digitalization and demographics. It also discusses the different types of employee experiences that affect work, why they matter, and how they are shaped by employee expectations, perceptions, and interpretations. Work Technology and Organizational Agility, Chapter 3. Work technology refers to solutions designed to build and manage workforces to deliver the goals of the business. At the broadest level, this technology focuses on doing five basic things: enabling people decisions such as hiring or compensation, creating work communities and teams, supporting employee development, ensuring security and compliance, and reducing time needed to complete administrative actions. Chapter 3 explains the role that different types of work technology play in creating more agile organizations. It focuses particularly on the value technology provides by enabling large companies to act more like small entrepreneurial organizations. Perennial Workforce Challenges, Chapters 4 through 8. Chapters 4 through 8 examine the future of work from the perspective of 7 perennial workforce challenges. These challenges are called perennial because companies always have to address them, and they never go away. They include designing organizations, filling roles, ensuring employees have the skills to perform their work, engaging employees to achieve company goals, increasing efficiency of work, complying with laws and regulations, and building culturally effective companies. These challenges can also be viewed from an employee perspective, such as finding career opportunities, learning new skills, accomplishing career goals, achieving success, and making effective use of time. The 7 perennial workforce challenges provide a sense of order in the fast-changing world of work. I like to compare them to the perennial challenges associated with throwing a great party, because both have to do with creating positive experiences. For organizations, it is about creating experiences that inspire employees to work collaboratively to achieve company goals. A perennial challenge to throwing a good party is figuring out what music will inspire people to dance. In the 1920s, people solved this challenge by playing ragtime music on a Victrola. Now we download a playlist of current hits from the web. Similarly, people's expectations about work and the technology they expect to use in organizations has changed since the 1920s. But the basic challenges to building workforces and throwing parties have not changed because they are about psychological truths. Employees want to be appreciated at work, and people want to dance at parties. What changes are the nature of people's expectations when it comes to doing these things, and the available technology to meet these expectations. The perennial workforce challenges never change, but the relative importance of each challenge changes in response to company growth, business market conditions, and shifting labor markets. The methods used to address the challenges also change due to technological innovation. For example, the internet profoundly altered how companies fill roles, and remote work technology is radically changing how companies design organizations. Chapters 4 to 8 examine these challenges from the perspective of their impact on employee experience and how technology is transforming the methods companies use to address them. Designing organizations to provide positive employee experiences. Chapter 4 is about determining what jobs define the company, where they are located, and how they are organized and compensated. In the past, companies approached organizational design mainly as a financial activity, with employee experience an afterthought. More attention needs to be placed on the employee experience, recognizing that people do not join companies to fill department headcount requirements. They join because something about the organization appeals to them. The top issue on employees' minds when considering a job or going through a corporate restructuring is not how will this help the company's financial portfolio. It is how will this affect my job experience, career opportunities, and work relationships. Filling positions and the experience of moving into new roles. Chapter 5 is about finding and hiring people to perform different functions, including transferring people internally based on business needs and career interests. In the past, companies assumed they could find talent when they needed it. This is no longer the case for many jobs. Companies must look at hiring from an employee experience perspective, recognizing that people do not want to be qualified, selected, and onboarded. They want to discover opportunities, learn about roles, be welcomed into organizations, and develop new careers. This means filling roles based on what candidates want and not just what companies need. Developing Capabilities and the Employee Experience of Learning, Chapter 6, is about providing people with knowledge and skills to perform current work and take on future responsibilities. In the past, development programs focused on making incremental improvements to employees' existing capabilities through training. This approach worked when careers were more stable and linear. This view of career growth no longer makes sense in many industries. It is not enough to train employees for their current job if their current job is likely to radically change or disappear due to automation. Companies need a new approach that views development as enabling people to do things that are much different from what they did in the past. Creating engagement and employee experiences that inspire successful performance, Chapter 7, is about guiding, inspiring, supporting, and retaining employees to achieve the goals of the company. Companies must put considerable effort into engaging employees in a high-pressure world where people can easily change jobs if they are not fully supported in their roles. Another topic discussed in this chapter is team performance dynamics, recognizing that the performance of the people we work with has a major impact on our own experience of work, particularly when we are under pressure. Increasing efficiency, ensuring compliance and security, and building culture, Chapter 8, is about how companies can address the first four challenges in ways that optimize the time and money spent on workforce management activities, comply with employment regulations, laws, and contracts, address security and compliance risks, and support cultural values related to health and well-being, diversity and inclusion, and environmental sustainability. This chapter also discusses the importance of hybrid remote work cultures. People do not want to work for companies that do not respect their time, privacy, safety, rights, and values, nor do they want to work for companies that force them to relocate or commute to an office if they feel it is unnecessary to doing their job. What makes the seven perennial challenges different from a traditional process view of human resources, HR, that focuses on things such as recruiting, training, or performance management, is their intercomplementary nature. As the nature of work changes, the distinction between traditional HR processes is disappearing. For example, the design of a company's organization influences how it fills job roles and develops employee capabilities. Training is one method to develop employees, but staffing can be a more powerful tool for development if used in the right way. One of the most effective ways to get someone to learn how to do something is to put them in a job that requires knowing how to do it, and then help them develop the capabilities and skills they need to succeed. An overarching theme in the future of work is moving away from narrow, process-oriented views of workforce management toward methods that use a range of techniques to address broad workforce challenges. Using employee data to guide business decisions, Chapter 9. Companies are gaining access to unprecedented levels of data about a workforce. Companies have much to gain from leveraging this data to increase workforce efficiency, ensure compliance, and better understand, influence, and predict employee behavior. Yet many companies make little use of this information or use it ineffectively. Benefiting from data requires developing methods to collect and analyze workforce data in an efficient, sustainable manner, giving the data meaning by framing them in the context of business problems and managing concerns about data privacy and security. Changing Employee Experience, Chapter 10. Talent tectonic shifts are forcing companies to solve old challenges in new ways. It can be difficult to get leaders to realize that the way the company solved perennial challenges in the past will not work now. Companies often persist in doing things the way they have always been done simply because they have always done it that way, using technology to incrementally improve existing work methods as opposed to making large-scale changes to improve employee experience. This chapter discusses common barriers to changing work practices, including why leaders dislike changes, why managers struggle to support changes, and why employees resist them. Employee Experience and the External Environment. Chapter 11. The experiences that people have at work are influenced by experiences they have outside of work. This chapter discusses societal issues that shape and often constrain the ability to reimagine the nature of employee experience, noting how many of our current views about work are still rooted in social norms and work technology constraints from the 20th century. Where do we go from here? Chapter 12. The book concludes with general thoughts about how work will evolve over the coming years and the role companies play in shaping the future of employee experience. The vocabulary used in this book. When it comes to talking about work, words matter. For example, I know companies who refer to employees as partners, associates, champions, athletes, team members, cast members, or crew members, and are adamant that their employees be referred to by these names. There are valid reasons why companies rename or redefine common terms, but it creates confusion when working across companies. For this reason, here are the definitions for some commonly used terms in this book. Organization. A group of people who collaborate to achieve common goals by sharing common resources. The terms company and organization are used interchangeably, though not all organizations are commercial companies, e.g., government or nonprofit organizations. Employee. A person who receives financial compensation from an organization for work they perform on the organization's behalf. This includes contract workers as well as direct employees. The terms employees, workers, and people are used fairly interchangeably. Candidate. A person who may have the potential to become an employee. An applicant is a candidate who has expressed interest in a certain job role. Manager. A person who has responsibility for guiding the work of employees. Many managers oversee staffing and compensation decisions, but not all do. Leader. A person responsible for setting the strategic direction of a company or group. Many leaders are also managers. Digitalization. The application of technology in a way that transforms, augments, automates, or otherwise noticeably changes some aspect of work and life. Rating. Assessing and placing people in different categories based on qualifications, potential, performance, or some other attribute relevant to work. Rating requires categorization, but does not require using numerical labels, ranking people against each other, or evaluating people as better or worse individuals. Talent. The capabilities employees possess that enable them to achieve business-related objectives, including knowledge, skills, abilities, values, motives, and attitudes. Skilled employees are also sometimes referred to as talent. Workforce. Used to refer to all employees working for a company, including senior leaders and contractors, as well as to refer to the labor force available in a broader society. Workforce management. Methods, actions, and processes focused on helping organizations create effective workforces. Other terms used for this include human resources, human capital management, or human experience management. I strive to use these and other words in a consistent manner throughout the book. I also try to avoid marketing jargon, trendy terms, and other phrases that often sound good but mean little. Applying these concepts to the world you live and work in. The nature of work is being transformed by the talent tectonic forces of digitalization and demographics. Companies must get far better at attracting, developing, and engaging employees to deal with a world characterized by accelerating change and growing skill shortages. This requires using technology to rethink how companies design organizations, fill roles, develop capabilities, engage performance, increase efficiency, ensure compliance, and build cultures. Companies that succeed in the future may not have the biggest market share, strongest brand reputation, or most charismatic leaders, but they will have highly capable and adaptable workforces. Going through the following steps and questions with leaders you work with will help connect concepts in this book to specific challenges they are facing. Step 1. Talk with business leaders about the company's operational strategy. What goals must the company achieve to meet commitments and expectations of its financial shareholders, external customers, and/or constituents? How does the company plan to drive profit and growth over the coming years? What does it plan to do in the future that it is not currently doing today? 3 years is usually a good time frame for answering these questions, although the ideal length can vary depending on the nature of the company. What challenges will it have to overcome to be successful? Step 2. Explore the implications this strategy has on the company's workforce. What kinds of employees will the company need to hire in the future? How are they different from the kinds of employees hired in the past in terms of skills, location, interests, and other characteristics? What things will current employees have to do in the future that are different from what they are doing now? What types of employees must the company attract or retain to successfully execute its business strategy? Step 3. Review the 7 perennial workforce challenges. Which perennial workforce challenges will be most critical for the company over the coming years? What must the company change about its current workforce management methods to create and sustain the type of workforce it will need to meet its future business goals? What aspects of the company's current employee experience must be changed to create the work environment needed to attract and support the kind of talent it needs to succeed? Chapter 1. Forces Reshaping Work and Workforces. We do not have to sit together to work together. During spring 2020, millions of employees shifted from working in offices to working remotely from home to protect people during the COVID-19 pandemic. Company leaders soon learned, often to their surprise, that the shift to remote work led to increased employee engagement, productivity, and sense of belonging. These benefits happened even though the move to remote work was done to protect health, not to improve employee experience. Employees missed in-person interactions and access to workspaces outside of their homes, but welcomed greater control over their time and not having to commute to work every day. As one customer I work with shared after adopting remote work, "We don't want to go back to normal. We want to go forward to better." And better meant permanently embracing some hybrid mixture of remote and on-site work. The fact companies shifted to remote work in a matter of weeks means the technology to support remote work was widely available before the pandemic. In fact, many people had been working remotely for decades. However, few companies embraced the concept of remote work prior to the pandemic. The positive reaction of employees showed that had remote work been supported before the pandemic, many people would have embraced it much earlier. People disliked commuting to work every day, but prior to the pandemic, they were not given an alternative, even though it was technologically possible to work remotely. The pandemic forced companies to rethink long-standing assumptions about work, especially the belief that employees need to be in an office to do a good job. It forced company leaders to accept that in a digitalized world, we do not have to sit together to work together. The phrase talent tectonics describes underlying shifts reshaping work and organizations, much like underlying geographic tectonic plates reshape the surface of the earth. Using this analogy of talent tectonics, the shift to remote work in 2020 can be likened to an earthquake. It was a sudden change in the visible nature of work that was made possible because of underlying advancements in technology that had been happening over decades. People in the 20th century did not want to commute to work every day, but they had no choice given existing technology. With the advent of the internet in the 1990s, the concept of remote work became more viable. For 30-plus years, remote work technology steadily improved, but few companies took advantage of it. In 2019, less than 5% of work was done remotely. This shot up to over 60% in 2020, and then dropped back to about 30% in 2021. Remote work was a possibility before 2020, but what was needed was some triggering event to change people's attitudes. Sadly, it took a pandemic to get companies to rethink assumptions about the importance of having employees commute to office buildings every day. Once this triggering event occurred, the change happened extremely quickly and forever altered the landscape of work. The biggest talent tectonic forces currently affecting work are digitalization and demographics. Figure 1.1, located in the print version of this book, summarizes how these tectonic forces are changing work using the concept of fault lines. In geology, fault lines are where we visibly see or experience forces caused by the movement of tectonic plates through mountain ranges, coastlines, volcanoes, and earthquakes. Fault lines in talent tectonics are visible changes to the nature of work and organizations. The most visible impact of digitalization on companies is an accelerating rate of change. Business markets, customer preferences, supply chain operations, and every other aspect of business is being transformed by technology. Digitalization is also changing the nature of jobs and work. Automation is eliminating some jobs and simultaneously creating new kinds of work. The work people are being asked to do is different from what people did in the past. This is increasing demand for employees who possess or can quickly learn new skills. In many cases, this means specialized technical skills or exceptional service or creative skills. But it can also increase the importance of relatively common skills. For example, people with good typing skills have an advantage when working in virtual teams, presumably because it involves greater use of electronic communications technology, such as chat and email. The most visible impacts of demographics on companies are changes in the labor market. The median age of the workforce has been rising for decades. Many countries have reached a point where, for the first time in history, more workers are aging out of the labor market than entering it. Figure 1.2, located in the print version of this book, shows the projected 2025 age pyramids for the world's 10 largest economies. Each image shows the percentage of men and women in the country at different ages. Of these countries, India is the only one that is not seeing the size of its working age population shrink, or at least not as severely. Companies in these countries must adapt to a new reality in which fewer young people are entering the labor market relative to the number of older people leaving it. A direct impact of declining birth rates is increased shortages of people willing to do the work companies want at the wages companies want to pay. Workforce shortages also enable employees to have more influence over the work they do. When there are more job openings than qualified candidates to fill them, candidates are able to demand jobs tailored to their unique interests. The workforce is also becoming more diverse due to variations in birth rates across demographic groups, coupled with the growing role of immigrant labor. Many less economically developed countries in Africa and elsewhere have far higher birth rates compared to the countries in Figure 1.2, located in the print version of this book. These countries have smaller job markets and higher unemployment, and immigration from these countries is often used to address the aging of the workforce in other countries. Companies will increasingly have to recruit talent from much more diverse domestic and international labor markets than those used in the past. The talent tectonic forces of digitalization and demographics have been slowly changing the nature of economies and societies for decades. What is new are the increasingly visible impacts they are having on the nature of work. Digitalization is changing what companies need people to do, and demographics are changing the characteristics of the people available to do it. These changes require companies to rethink how employees are managed and how jobs and organizations are designed. Companies must put what employees want on equal footing with what companies need, and societies must challenge long-standing assumptions about the nature of education, work, unemployment, and retirement if they want a population capable of competing in the 21st century global labor market. We cannot know exactly how these talent tectonic forces will change work, but we can make an educated guess by taking a deeper look at the major impacts of digitalization and demographics. The impacts of digitalization. Thousands of statistics illustrate how rapidly technology is expanding into every aspect of work and life. Here are just a few. There are about 1.35 million tech startups around the world. We generate 2.5 quintillion bytes of data daily. People check their mobile phones about 150 times daily. Every second, 127 new devices are connected to the Internet. 3.9 billion people were active in social media platforms in 2021. There were 81,000 searches on Google every second in 2020. These statistics are based on a web search done on November 1, 2021. By the time you listen to this, most of them will be considerably larger. Technology has become so prevalent in our lives that it is creating new medical and psychological syndromes, e.g. smartphone pinky, compulsive phone checking. There is a $40 billion plus category of technology solutions to manage stresses caused largely by use of technology. If there was a sign indicating how digital technology had taken over our lives, it is when smartphone manufacturers added applications that encouraged users to switch off their smartphones. 20 years ago, who would have predicted technology companies would build features designed to decrease the use of their products? The growth of digitalization is affecting every aspect of our lives, from how we meet our partners, buy our homes, and raise our children, to how we decide where to go for dinner and what movies to watch. It is fundamentally changing how companies design, market, sell, manufacture, and distribute products and services. It is altering the geopolitical landscape, how governments are elected, how wars are fought, and the actions we take to protect the planet we live on. Digitalization is also affecting the nature of work and organizations in three profound ways: accelerating the pace of change, transforming the purpose of work, and increasing the demand for specialized skills. Talent Tectonic Fault Line 1: Accelerating the Pace of Change. In 1963, a business professor observed that when it comes to companies, it is not the strongest that survives, but the one that is able best to adapt and adjust to the changing environment. This observation is even truer now. A recent study of top-performing businesses found most share a common characteristic, but it is not size or depth of resources. It is the ability to alter their strategy and quickly adapt to a changing business market. Digitalization has weakened the connection between company size and company success. In the past, companies that had large market shares and material resources could use these to overcome challenges. Strength of size enabled them to weather changes better than smaller competitors. Size still provides strengths, but it is not as valuable as it once was. In a digital world, the success of companies is more about an organization's adaptability than its existing assets. This is great news for smaller companies seeking to grow into big ones, but it is a threat for established companies where size and entrenched habits create inertia and bureaucracy that hinders change. The lifespan of organizations is shrinking as companies that once dominated their industries lose market share, get acquired, or go under entirely. The median age of the top S&P 500 companies decreased by 61% between 2000 and 2017. The median age across all S&P 500 companies in 2027 is predicted to be a mere 12 years. This means about 50% of the 500 largest companies in the U.S. will be younger than many children in primary school. This pace of change does not just affect companies. It also affects people working in them. The stress of constant change is reflected in increasing mental health, burnout, and well-being issues. A growing source of anxiety among employees is fear of losing their job due to changes in the economy or nature of work. People are as concerned about losing their job to another person due to outsourcing as they are to losing it due to automation. Somewhat counterintuitively, the labor market disruption caused by digitalization has not yet changed the frequency with which people change jobs. Despite a common belief that kids these days quit jobs more, in many countries, the employees born in the 1980s and 1990s are on track to have roughly the same number of job transitions as employees born in the 1950s and 1960s. What is different is the nature of these job changes. In the past, after a certain age, people tended to keep working in the same industry. That will not be the case in a world where industries are being radically transformed by technology. Many employees know that whatever they are doing now, they probably won't be doing the same thing 5 years from now. That things will change is certain. What is not certain is whether these changes will make their lives better. Talent Tectonic Fault Line 2: Transforming the Purpose of Work. The last major transformation in work caused by technology occurred in the 18th and 19th centuries during the Industrial Age. Technological innovation, fueled by the development of steam and electrical power, changed the focus of work from farming to manufacturing. Technological innovations drastically reduced the time and labor needed to produce food and materials. The use of technology in the Industrial Age changed how organizations, cities, and entire societies operated. For example, at the start of the 19th century, about 70% of U.S. workers lived on farms. By the start of the 20th century, fewer than 5% did. Figure 1.3, located in the print version of this book, shows how the nature of work in the United States changed during and after the Industrial Revolution from agricultural and manufacturing work toward service work. The same general shift shown in this figure is happening around the world, although the timing varies across countries. For the past 50-plus years, we have been moving from a somewhat manufacturing-oriented economy to one where the majority of workers perform knowledge and service-oriented jobs. The kinds of service jobs have also changed. Up through the mid-20th century, most service work involved relatively low-paying jobs, such as housekeepers or clerks. Now, many service jobs are specialized, high-paying professions, such as healthcare providers or business consultants. In 1949, the most common service jobs in the U.S. were food service and restaurant worker, followed by janitor, servant, cook, and security guard. The most common service jobs in 2021 still includes food service workers, but it also includes registered nurses. The shift to more knowledge-oriented service jobs is a result of technology changing the nature of work, but in much different ways than that of the industrial age. Economists refer to the transitions in Figure 1.3 as shifting between agricultural and manufacturing to service economies. In each transition, the focus of work changed toward producing different types of goods and services. A psychologist's view is slightly different. Instead of viewing each era in terms of things workers are producing for society, one can view them in terms of the societal needs that workers are addressing. Up until the 18th century, the main purpose of work was to fulfill lower-order survival needs. People worked so societies had food to live. During the Industrial Age, the purpose of work shifted from the need to stay alive to the desire to live comfortably. Technology enabled more people to shift from spending time providing food to creating things that make living more enjoyable. Technology is now making it possible to shift work toward an even higher order need, creating experiences and relationships to make life happy and fulfilling. We are still a long way from ensuring all people have the basic needs of food and shelter, but we are far closer to it than we were 100 years ago. Consequently, societies are starting to devote more of work toward a new purpose, providing things that do not just keep people alive and comfortable, but that make them feel enriched and fulfilled. Tragically, vast numbers of people die each year due to starvation and poor living conditions, despite humanity having adequate material resources to feed and house everyone on the planet. It is possible that we may already have the technological capability to give everyone the opportunity to live a fulfilling life, but it is a major challenge to actually do it. Adequate food and comfortable living conditions are necessary for a happy and fulfilling life, but they do not make life happy and fulfilling. It is psychologically unhealthy to seek happiness solely through consuming food and acquiring material possessions. What makes us truly happy are the experiences we have in life and the people we experience them with. Technology is enabling us to focus more work resources on providing people with meaningful and happy lives. This does not mean work focused on creating food and making things that provide shelter and comfort is disappearing. We need farmers and manufacturers, but fewer people are needed to do work related to farming and manufacturing due to technology. Consequently, an increasing percentage of work is shifting to creating experiences that make people feel good. This includes activities such as interacting with friends and family, improving our mental and physical health and well-being, going on trips, watching entertainment events, playing games, and others that provide positive experiences and foster healthy relationships. Technology is not eliminating work. It is altering the purpose of work from growing food and making things to providing services and experiences. This shift in the purpose of work is also changing the capabilities and conditions employees need to effectively perform their jobs. The industrial era of the 20th century characterized work as a transactional contract between employees and companies that emphasized paying employees based on time spent at work or production of tangible things. Cynically, employees were expected to show up, shut up, and make stuff. Anyone who thinks the world of work is becoming worse because of technology does not know much about what work was like 100 years ago. A lot of jobs in the industrial era were miserable. They involved repetitive, physically exhausting work in unpleasant, dangerous environments. Employees were expected to follow specific rules and were discouraged from being creative. The stressful command-and-control style of management common in the industrial age literally shortened people's lifespan. How employees felt didn't matter as long as they created what they were paid to make. Employees did this work only because they had to. Happily, technology has made it possible to automate most of this work, so now no one has to do it. In the 21st century, employees are increasingly employed to generate ideas, build relationships, solve problems, and deliver services to others. It is hard to be creative, caring, or collaborative if you feel stressed, exhausted, or mistreated. There is a big difference between telling employees to rivet iron plates for 8 hours or load 16 tons of coal, compared to asking them to show these customers we care about them or find ways to build our market share. How employees feel internally matters more now because the purpose of work has changed. Work is becoming physically easier but mentally more difficult. There is a concept in psychology called emotional labor that defines the experience of acting differently from how we feel internally. Acting happy when we feel sad is not just difficult, it is stressful and often unhealthy. Companies cannot be successful in the future if they try to coerce employees to do work purely through tying tasks to external rewards, such as compensation. Employees have to sincerely enjoy their work to be good at it. To be successful in this new era, work should not be thought of as a transactional contract built on requirements. It should be viewed as a supportive partnership based on shared trust and mutual goals. To do this, companies must demonstrate they are trustworthy and show they care about creating positive work experiences for employees. This does not mean work should be easy or stress-free. To the contrary, we enjoy our work the most when it challenges us to fully apply and develop our capabilities. But work should not feel like a prison of measured time. Work should be something that people find meaningful and fulfilling. Talent Tectonic Fault Line 3: Increasing Demand for Specialized Skills. Digitalization changes jobs by automating repetitive tasks and augmenting human activities. An example of automation is using robots to move packages in a warehouse, so a person does not have to do it. An example of augmentation is using artificial intelligence to scan X-ray images to help radiologists more quickly find and diagnose tumors. Technology supports people by performing tasks that people did in the past or by enabling things that people want to do in the future. Technology can also have unintended consequences, creating things that we did not want, from messing up our sleep through blue light to potentially exterminating our species through pollution. As technology applications become more powerful, they enable automating and augmenting increasingly complex activities to the point that they often seem intelligent, but they are not actually intelligent in the human sense. The term artificial intelligence, AI, gained widespread use in the 1960s to describe mathematical algorithms and computer programming techniques designed to model psychological theories of human learning and decision-making. My father, Earl Hunt, did early work in AI and explained that we discovered that computers aren't very good at mimicking how the human brain actually works, but they are good at solving complex problems that the human brain could never solve, and they do it by acting like computers, not by acting like people. The computer science of AI quickly diverged from the psychological science of human intelligence, and most modern applications of AI have little in common with how people actually think or learn. Calling these complex mathematical models artificial intelligence is like calling lifesaver candies artificial fruit. There may be surface similarities between the organic version and the artificial version, but they are not at all the same. Technology as complex as self-driving cars is amazingly impressive, but at its core, it is still automating and augmenting tasks that were either previously performed by humans or envisioned by humans as being something worth doing. Technology does not replace the need for people, but it does change what people need to do. When technology is applied to an existing job, it tends to create two new types of jobs. Technical jobs focused on developing, maintaining, and using the technology. These jobs tend to be associated with operations, engineering, maintenance, analytics, and programming. Service jobs to engage or support customers who receive the products and experiences associated with the technology. This creates new jobs associated with marketing, sales, and customer support. A good example of how digitalization changes the nature of work is the way online shopping technology is changing retail jobs. The events of 2020 massively accelerated online shopping. As one retail CIO put it, "We achieved our 5-year online growth plan in 5 weeks." But online shopping did not replace physical stores the way many people thought it would. It turns out that the presence of physical stores influences online purchases. One retail company found that opening a store led to a 30% increase in online purchases from the local community. People become more attached to brands that have physical store locations. Certain items, such as perishable groceries, are better purchased in person than online, and physical stores play a critical role in the supply chain supporting curbside pickup and home delivery. Online shopping is not eliminating the need for physical stores, but it is changing their function. The main purpose of stores used to be making it easy for customers to find and purchase products. Customers increasingly use the internet for this type of transactional shopping. The purpose of stores is becoming more about entertaining, educating, and engaging customers, often to sell products online. For example, customers may go to a store to try on clothes and get advice from a fashion consultant, or talk about hiking equipment with an expert in outdoor activities. In these examples, the job of store employees is to create a compelling social experience that attracts customers and influences both their in-store and online shopping behaviors. The digitalization of shopping is changing the nature of retail jobs. In-store employees are now being asked to switch between fulfilling online orders and assisting in-store customers. This includes helping in-store customers make online purchases and answering questions about online services that support in-store products, e.g. maintenance programs. Store staff members must be skilled at demonstrating, inspiring, and instructing customers on the value that comes from using company products. This requires a higher level of expertise than what was historically required for many frontline retail jobs. The employee is not just helping customers find and purchase products in the store. They are building the company brand to influence future online product purchases. The shift to online shopping is also creating highly specialized technical jobs that integrate in-store layouts, online shopping platforms, and mobile technology to create new kinds of customer experiences, e.g. using smartphones so customers can see what products will look like in their own home. Many of these jobs require skills that did not even exist 5 years ago. As the retail example shows, the more digitalization transforms work, the more companies need people with specialized skills to operate technology or provide experiences that connect customers to the company. Digitalization is not eliminating the need for work. It is changing the type of work we do. Similar examples can be found in every industry, ranging from mining to healthcare. Digitalization eliminates some jobs while creating new ones. The pace at which jobs are changing due to digitalization varies across countries, but this general trend is the same around the world. Companies will always need employees, but what they will need employees to do will require new and increasingly specialized skills. This includes people who are highly skilled at integrating different areas of specialization. As has been said, the future will be like the past, but different. The impacts of demographics. Historically, demographic shifts in the labor force were mainly a result of immigration and population changes caused by wars, persecution, famine, or disease. For example, the migration of people from Asia and Europe to North America in the 19th and 20th centuries was driven by opportunities found in the growing U.S. economy. Many immigrants were fleeing adverse, if not horrific, social conditions. But the reason they went to North America instead of somewhere else was primarily economic. It was a place they could find work and build a better life for their families. These shifts occurred in a relatively short amount of time, and their impact was immediately visible in society. By contrast, the major demographic shifts currently reshaping labor markets are driven by changes in birth rates and lifespans. These modern shifts are like plate tectonic shifts in the sense that they happen so slowly we do not notice them until something occurs that makes us suddenly realize the world has changed. We feel the effects of plate tectonic shifts when we experience earthquakes and volcanoes. We feel the effects of modern demographic shifts when we experience labor market crises and social unrest. The demographic shifts affecting the modern labor market are a result of more than 100 years of steady change. Starting in the 19th century, birth rates in many countries started to decline. This was due to changing economic conditions and social norms, including an increase in women's education levels. At the same time, people's lifespans began increasing as medical and living conditions improved. These trends were temporarily interrupted by World Wars I and II and the subsequent baby boom, but accelerated again starting in the 1960s. These trends are moderated by a country's culture and economy, but in almost every part of the world, birth rates have been declining and lifespans have been increasing. As a result, many countries are entering a phase in which more people.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.